I'm saying that I'm sitting in New York City, and I have just been sent a photograph of the cinema in Rochester that Rajesh sent me, and I am extremely happy to know that Dirty Wars has just screened in Rochester, and I can now see some of you in the audience. Oh, that's a beautiful sight. And I want to say, before we talk about the film, the importance of seeing the film in theaters, especially in this time we're living in, when we're being told more and more that progress is watching films and experiencing news on our own, alone in our homes. And the smaller the screen, the better. One of the goals in making this film was that it would screen in cinemas, because the film is meant to be a starting point for a conversation. It's not meant to in any way end the discussion, but begin one. And so I'm delighted that you're all there. The irony is that I don't think I can hear any of you, and I wanted to listen as much as speak. But let's see what... Oh, I'm being sent a message? No?
Okay. Can we call him on the phone?
Okay. Hello.
Okay, so you hear me now?
I hear you now, and I just wondered if somehow in hooking the computer up to the sound system, we muted the computer.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, we could shut down Skype and start it up again, but I think this will actually work if I put on speaker.
Okay, well, let's try this then. And am I still, will I be able to hear people?
Yes. I think so. Anybody who comes up,
okay.
Here, yeah, anybody who comes up here will be able to talk to you. So, I'm going to introduce you to the professor here who's actually teaching Dirty Wars in his classroom. This is Professor Murray from the local Nazareth College.
Hi, David.
Yes, speaker.
What's the group?
He's on speaker.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yes, I do. I hear you well.
Great. Well, I just want to tell you, having read the book, this is the first time I've seen the film, and I think it's a wonderful rendition of the book. I wondered if you could talk to us a little bit about when the decision was made to make the film. I know there's a lot of scenes from when Jeremy was investigating for the book, when he was in Somalia, etc. Was that a camera person for the film actually doing that, or were these camera people who had just come along with Jeremy and then later decided to make the film?
Okay, so and did everyone there hear your question?
Yeah.
I don't know what system. Yes. Okay. So. The short answer is, or to begin with, the film crew consisted of one person named Richard Rowley, along with Jeremy Scahill. The two of them did all of the work, the investigative work in Somalia, in Afghanistan, in Yemen, on their own. They would have a translator with them, but there was no film crew the way we tend to think of that. And they decided, when Jeremy began the work of researching the book, they decided to just explore what it would be like to document the process. They didn't at the outset have a very clear idea what it would lead to, partly because Jeremy himself was doing an open-ended investigation. He didn't try to find evidence on the planet to support some hypothesis. He really was beginning the work that he does as a reporter, and Richard went along on these trips and started filming it. At a certain point, they realized that they were actually making a film. And what's interesting, I think, for people tonight, having just seen the film, just to keep in mind, is that at no point during the filming did Jeremy acknowledge or really even entertain the thought that he'd be a character in the film. In fact, throughout the process, if Richard started to film Jeremy, Jeremy would insist that he turn the camera away, because Jeremy has never been the subject of his work, and he didn't understand why Richard was filming him. Richard is a very experienced veteran war reporter who, over the course of the last 15 years, has made probably 20 documentary shorts about the war on terror in conflict zones. And his instinct as a director cinematographer is to film everything while he's working. So he was constantly filming Jeremy. A year and a half after they began work, they started editing what at the time that I became involved was a 4-hour rough cut. And they asked me if I had any suggestions, if I'd look at the footage. And my first and clearest suggestion was that Jeremy be a character. That the watching the footage, much of which you've seen tonight, I was struck by two things. The first is that it's overwhelming. Hearing these stories in the voices of the people who are experiencing this war on the other end of the gun was emotionally overwhelming for me, and I couldn't help but wonder why I had not heard these before. When I'm someone who is always trying to pay attention to the news, there was something about these stories that the family in Al Majla and the family in Gardez that was so powerful, and I realized the reason I haven't heard these stories is because there's an enormous effort made to prevent me, living in the United States, from ever hearing these voices. The second realization was that Jeremy and Richard, who were sitting there with me, had gone through a very difficult process to bring that back. And that the idea that we have of news reporters who somehow are never affected by their work is a false one, especially given how difficult it is these days to hear directly from people if we live in the center of empire. And I felt that somehow it was meaningful, it was relevant to see what it actually took for this journalist to do his investigation. And so in the editing room, a process began of looking at how a thread that would guide us from one story to another would actually be the investigative process of a journalist working today when you are deliberately blocked from having access to people. You know, the stories that they share from Kabul, both Jeremy and Richard, is that the press, the stories are already fabricated for you. They're manufactured. The press office tells you each morning in a tear sheet what the best stories are, and they have the people ready for you to talk to. The fact that to do real investigative journalism requires getting, quote, out of the green zone started to become a guiding principle. And then the question was, does that have any impact on the person? And I have known Jeremy a very long time, and I couldn't help but see that it had taken a toll on him. And so that's a very long answer, but the film evolved somewhat organically as they were working, and then in the edit room began to take the shape that it's in now.
Okay, do we? Okay, Doug is ready for a question?
Yeah, hi. Thank you for this film. Many of us here...
Get the mic on.
Many of us here have been very active in opposing drone attacks and the kill lists related to them. But it seems like the drone attacks and the targeted killing associated, done by drones, is really the tip of the iceberg and really a very small proportion of the targeted killing going on around the world by JSOC, et cetera, and by their proxies. And I wonder if you could speak to that, that are we limiting our focus on drones inappropriately?
Well, I see, to begin with, I see the t-shirt, and I've been told that Rochester Against War was one of the organizers. So a shout out to you. I myself had the same reaction as a filmmaker and as a writer when I started to see the stories that Jeremy and Richard were reporting on. And I wondered, why is it that I had heard so little? I'd actually heard nothing about JSOC myself. And yet I had been aware of the drones much more. And it was, just to remind people tonight, it was while the film was being made that the Bin Laden strike happened. It was in the middle of the process of making the film, and it was this very surreal moment of suddenly feeling that this very deeply buried secret that we were investigating was suddenly front page news. But what Jeremy says at every talkback is that we have been told about Bin Laden's raid. We've been told every known detail about it because it's the one JSOC raid that they want us to know about. But at the very same night, there were dozens of JSOC raids being conducted in different countries. And the fact that today, this highly secretive force of assassins is operating in 100 countries around the world is, I think it's unprecedented. I don't mean unprecedented in terms of the number of people who are being assassinated. We can speak about long periods of American history, most recently the Phoenix program in Vietnam. But the fact that right now, tonight, these trained killers are in 100 or more than 100 countries is unprecedented. In terms of whether our focus is misguided, I would say no. I think our job is to keep expanding our awareness and to make links between these things. And one of the reasons Jeremy chose to call his book Dirty Wars and the film Dirty Wars, even though it has obvious associations for many people with the stories of the Dirty Wars in Central America, was that we are being told today, more than ever by Obama, that this is a clean war, that there is such a thing as a clean war, and that it happens without anyone suffering except the bad guys in these targeted killings. And whether those targeted killings are being done with a drone or with a cruise missile or with a professional hit squad of assassins makes no difference to the people on the receiving end. So linking them, I think, is the key. And if there's a public awareness, an increasingly public awareness around drones, our job is to start expanding that, linking it to new questions that we have. And I would just add to that this film has come out at the same time that the Snowden and the Manning, heroic work has been transforming our awareness of what is being done by the national security state, where we now see, many of us might have felt it a long time, but it's now clear as day that the US national security state wants to know everything about us. There is nothing that they consider off limits. They want to record our conversation tonight and store it in my file for the rest of my life, so that if at any moment I take a misstep, they can recall it all. They want to know everything about us, and at the same time, they want us to know nothing about them. So our job is to shed light, to really strip down all of the covers that they're hiding behind. And the work of the movement around drones is part of that. We have to add JSOC to that. We have to add the whole, surveillance state to that. I see it as sort of expanding and linking all of these in the same movement.
Thank you.
Yeah. Well, okay, I'm a Vietnam veteran, and I noticed you mentioned the Phoenix program, and actually the special, or JSOC, had an analog in Vietnam long before it became an official war zone, and that was MACV SOG, Military Assistance Command Vietnam Special Operations Group, carrying out the same sort of thing. And I would suggest the story, as horrific as it is, it's much deeper, that in fact, ever since World War II, the U.S. has been involved in a series of undeclared wars. The reason being, if they went into a declared war, there's a possibility of nuclear war breaking out. But yet, the military-industrial complex that Eisenhower warned us about needs the profits. And therefore, we have these undeclared wars that make sense only to the extent that they generate profits for Wall Street. Is there any thought of investigating the potential links between JSOC and Wall Street, much as there are definite links between Wall Street and the CIA? Many of the people in charge of the CIA have always had very close links with Wall Street. The Alan Dulles, the founder of the CIA, came from Wall Street. Is there any thought of expanding these investigations into those links?
I mean, I think what you're saying is both true and extremely important. I have to say that my, you know, Jeremy really is the expert on the particulars. What one thing that I would want to say about JSOC that distinguishes it from antecedents is that it was designed to be under the direct vertical control of the executive, directly as a presidential hit squad, and that was after the failed hostage rescue with Carter was one of the kind of conceptual ideas that formed JSOC. And in Jeremy's book, which is really extraordinary, is an encyclopedic look at the past 12 years. And one of the things he talks about now, in fact, the film with Tom Hanks called Captain Phillips is dealing with, is the story of the Maersk Alabama when Somali pirates took over a tanker. And Jeremy describes very, very powerfully how that was Obama's first experience of deploying JSOC, of actually ordering the kill of those pirates with JSOC snipers, and that it was exhilarating for him. This constitutional law professor came out of that moment seeing in real time, on his video screen, the pirates dropping one after another, extremely surgically, and without any intermediaries. Sitting in his office as president, he was pulling the triggers. And so that, I think, is part of what is unique or new to JSOC. But I completely agree with you that that what is happening today has a long history. It's important for us to see that what it really means to be living in the center of an empire, to be living in a country that has an imperial vocabulary so embedded in it that neighborhood conversations in schools and in you know around the coffee pot regularly revolve around whether or not we should be pulling out from this country or that country. It's almost now a conditioned reflex that we are being asked as Americans to take on that colonial and imperial cultural position. And I remember vividly the conversation about it's too soon to pull out from Iraq, it's too soon to pull out from Afghanistan. And this has infected us in a very serious way. I was told years ago that it's at the center of empire historically that we find the greatest level of ignorance. And what was meant by that is that there is a tremendous need to keep people at the heart of empire unaware of what is being done in their name. And this is why if you leave the United States, if you get outside of Europe, if you're able to travel in the global south, you'll find that people are not at all surprised. And they have a very direct connection to the history you're talking about. They make associations between the expansive wars of the 1960s and 70s and the wars today. And so shedding that ignorance is the priority for me as a writer. I'm trying to do it every day. And I think also for our movements.
Hello, this is Butch. There's a ton of things I would like to talk to you about, but I'm going to try to narrow the focus on something in particular here. It's about this mask and this preconditioning. You talked about it a little bit here, and other people have intimated about it. From where I see it, how we get conditioned, we experience this on a daily basis. Now, we're all aware of what the NSA trying to create this large database system, et cetera, to track our whereabouts, our habits, and what we're doing. And you even commented on it about infinitum somewhere in the future to pull back what you're currently doing today or the days before. However, why is it nobody gets either concerned or alarmed at when they walk into a department store that these ads pop up on their smartphone and tells them that there's a sale going on in this department over here and watches you loiter over these items that are for sale and actually track the amount of time that you're there in that store reading and looking at these sales that are there and not understand what that direct connection is to this larger piece that people are concerned about with the NSA, because that's literally tracking your whereabouts, learning your habits, seeing what you're interested in. Really, the true intelligence has been in Little Brother's hands for a long time, and Big Brother's finally seeing what the commercial aspects of that are, and in this case, the military-industrial complex we were talking about. I know that's a lot. Can you comment on any of that and anything that you might see in terms of connections and or what we as individuals need to do to become aware of the fact of how closely integrated these things are? Thank you.
Yeah, my God. Well, what I'll start by saying is I wish I was in Rochester tonight, you know, because what a great set of questions. And I think people, if I was there, I would invite others to respond, because I don't pretend to have special knowledge about how the private and commercial snooping into our lives is connected to this broader picture. But as a writer, I would say that we are broadly being sold a lie, which is that this technology is bringing us closer together. It feels that it is doing that, because here I am in New York, but I can be talking to you over the phone in Rochester. But in a very, very profound way, it's dividing us more than ever. And I know Jeremy often jokes, but he's not joking to make people laugh, but rather in a nervous way, that moving forward, we have to embrace a kind of Luddism, by which that means that we don't do these Skype calls, but we make an effort to be there in person. That the question you're raising tonight, I think, is probably relevant to everyone who's in the theater and all of their families. All of us who are parents and have kids who are growing up or becoming teenagers, we can see that there is a great danger to what seems like this incredibly seductive new technology. But we are completely inarticulate still. And I say we, I mean, broadly speaking, I think that we're inarticulate about how to resist it, what it really means to resist it, and what it means to move forward without being defeated by it. I think that's a big area for work in terms of our organizing efforts.
Hi. I wanted to indicate, and I think your last comments really are a segue into an expression of very, very deep gratitude, because I think it's so possible. There are a lot of veterans of movement activity in the theater this evening. And having heard Jeremy on a variety of media outlets over a period of time, this stunning peeling of the onion, if you will, kind of analysis, I think was so marvelously captured in the film. And I'm trying to figure out a way to take it into a variety of union meetings that I go to on a regular basis. It's clear to me that that you all do not do what you do out of a personal motivation, but I couldn't really leave the theater this evening without expressing deepest gratitude for the courage, personally, your commitment, the integrity in the work that at least your collective of three is doing, and how fundamentally important that is for the work that all the rest of us are trying to do, at least in a marginal way. But this is very profound, what the contribution that you all are making, and thank you so deeply.
Oh, thank you, and I just have to say, when you use the word marginal, I'm always reminded by an old professor of mine who taught in Rochester in the 1970s, named Peter Linebaugh.
Oh, yeah.
That it's the margin that holds the pages together in the book. And really that the work, there's no question to me that the work Jeremy and Rick have done is very courageous, but I think everybody who today is trying to get clarity on why the world they live in does not resemble the world they think they should be living in is courageous, whatever form that takes. The act of thinking for ourselves is courageous, and there is no hierarchy of value to the work we're doing. The fact that you're going from union meeting to union meeting is the starting point of so much of what is needed today. So I just want to sort of reflect that back at you, but thank you.
Okay. Hi. I just want to say that I'm really glad you're here with us tonight, because it does add another dimension to having seen the film, and that what you said about the or what was said about the tip of the iceberg, and also about the NSA and the different technologies separating us, sort of comes together in my mind, because I went to Pakistan and talked to some people from Waziristan a year ago, and what I learned when I was there was that their problem was the tip of the iceberg in Pakistan, because so many people were disappeared and imprisoned and killed along the border. Many of them are still actually in U.S. prisons in Afghanistan. We had no idea. You know, we only knew about the drone strikes. We didn't know about all these other people that were trashed along the way. But the fact that we're separated, and I think Jeremy's experience actually reflects it, is that all that technology, and they still can't get, you know, and they're still hitting households of people that are just more or less random, you know, and they're still picking up whoever it's easy to grab rather than, their so-called important high-value targets. And I wondered if, actually, I don't know if you have any comment, maybe Jeremy's one of the person to ask, but it seems to me like even the high-value targets aren't necessarily high-value, they're just like placeholders in the battle. And that the more you look at them, the less significant they seem in the big picture. And that just was my impression. So anyway, that was my question to people who saw that.
Well, I thank you. I of course I wish Jeremy was here to answer most of these questions. What I would say, just in the context of this film and the investigation, is first of all that the strategy of starting with a very select group of quote leadership and targeting them was true. And what we learn in the film from one of the JSOC operators is that as they would go down that list, the list would expand. And I think that touches on your comment, which is that we find ourselves now in a logic in which the ever-expanding list is a self-fulfilling prophecy. But there is no doubt that they have, you know, targets that they consider high value. But in the same way that the list becomes ever expansive, what we see now is that the experience of, and I use the example of the U.S. border just because I've done a lot of work over the years there. When the United States started building the border fence in Southern California in the mid-1990s, the number of border deaths immediately began to increase in Eastern California, going into Arizona. And over the past 15 years, as they've continued to focus their energies on certain sectors of the border, it's done nothing to address the fundamental economic realities that drive people to come north. It's simply shifted the focus of where their movements are, and that this is also what we see happening now with the apparent growth of militant jihadist organizations in increasing number of places, and this splintering effect that's happening. I'm not sure it's exactly a parallel to the ever-expanding kill list, but I think in some ways it is, and it raises a question that Jeremy tries to ask, but he doesn't pretend to answer, which is, what really is the plan then? If it's clear that targeting people on lists will only lead to an ever-expanding set of lists, and that the attack on these radical organizations will only lead to the growth of many new satellite organizations, surely the people at the epicenter of American imperial power are aware of this. And it raises the question of whether it is their design. I'm not sure that's what you're asking, but it certainly raises the question of whether or not it serves a purpose. And this is not something that we talk about directly in the film, and I certainly don't want to pretend that I have something especially valuable to contribute, but it's very difficult to do this research and study the patterns and not be left with a question, which is, what is the ultimate purpose? And certainly along the way, I have found myself asking whether it is not just a self-fulfilling prophecy. You want to have perpetual war, you need a perpetual kill list. You want to have perpetual war, you have to have perpetual enemies. And each time you put people on the kill list, you justify your squad of assassins.
This is a bit of a follow-up question about what you said about imperial wars. Without knowing the audience here tonight, I would guess that some of them may have left-leaning politics. And I'm wondering if you see any potential for a widening, not an outrage perhaps, but a widening desire to end foreign policy as we're conducting it now. I think part of it is that the war on terror narrative is so fixed and monolithic and so widespread that it's very hard to break away from it. But do you see maybe groups who might describe themselves as centrist or even on the right becoming tired of our engagements, either for lack, you know, no longer economically feasible, or just no longer worth it. Okay, I'll end it there. Thanks.
Well, I mean, it's a very important question, and I know that at many of the screenings that I've attended, people have gotten up to speak afterwards who are not on the left, who are active duty, who are special operators, or who are policy people. Part of the reason that Jeremy found so many people wanting to talk to him is because there's broad discontent about the approach that's being used, and the military itself. I mean, this is one of the most, for me, stunning acknowledgments in the film, when Matthew Ho resigns from the State Department, is that, and this can also be brought into the conversation around Libya and Benghazi, that these clandestine forces do their actions without the conventional military having, in many cases, any idea what's going on, and then they are left to deal with the consequences of uprisings and riots and you know, as the daylight breaks over a village or a town, people are enraged, and the conventional military doesn't know. So there is, to answer your question simply, I think that the film has found reception from all parts of society. The broader question about why have we not been successful as an anti-war movement, regardless of what our ideological stance is critical that we ask that, because we are now 13 years into the longest war in American history, and most Americans still have no idea what is going on. That the question that follows is, if people really did know what is going on, if Americans really knew what was being done in their name tonight, this very moment, would they acquiesce, would they accept it, or would they oppose it? That's a very important question. We won't know the answer until we can break the silence, until we can sort of shed light on this story, these stories that are hidden from our eyes. But my own belief is that that American people generally would oppose it. And I say that not because I'm Pollyannish, but because I see the immense effort that's made at the highest levels of American power to prevent us from seeing it. And I think that's done because there's a broad and deep sense that if Americans across the country really were able to look through the looking glass and see what's being done in their name, with their tax money, while their schools are being closed, while they're told that there's no money to support any essential programs at home, they would be outraged. I do believe that. But we sort of, I've gone on, all my answers have been too long, so let me just leave it at that.
Our microphone just died, so they, people can't hear what I'm saying, but you'll be able to redress my question.
Yes, yes.
Okay. But I just wanted to, first of all, thank you and your entire team, and especially Jeremy, for producing one of the most important films I've seen in a very long time. My question has to do with it's not working. My question has to do with the health and well-being and the security of Jeremy. How is he able to function on such a razor's edge with this kind of material? you made a connection to Edward Snowden, and many people will support the work that Edward Snowden did, but on one level I think Edward Snowden is a coward. He left here, he blew a very significant whistle, but he left here to seek refuge in one of the most repressive regimes in the world. So I don't see him in the same light that I see Jeremy Skaker. I think that he took the risks. They constantly put themselves in harm's way to produce something that is really important. So I wish you could address that and just talk a little bit about his health and well-being and where he goes from here. Where does it go from here? And thank you so much.
Okay, thank you. So we're down, this is sort of, we're down to a candle and one phone line, but I'm assuming people can still hear me.
Yeah.
It's very strange not to be able to see you all, but this gentleman is the manager of RCTV. As somebody who got his start in community television, oh, that's beautiful, thank you. In Somerville, Mass, I really appreciate the work and the role that community television plays. The question had to do with the health and well-being of Jeremy, and it was a broader comment, but specifically, what does it mean for Jeremy today, in practical terms, to be doing this work at the knife's edge of this war and of repression? And I'd like to answer it the way Jeremy does at Q&As, because it comes up at almost every screening. And he always says that whatever risks he has had to take as a journalist pales in comparison with the truly courageous work of journalists on the ground, who we never hear their names. In the film, we see one of them, Abdulela Haidashaya, locked up. And I just want people to know that he is out. It was a campaign led by Amnesty International in conjunction with the release of Dirty Wars in June that put pressure on the ruling party in Sana'a to release him. He's out. And we were told yesterday that he has a copy of Dirty Wars in his hands, that it was just delivered to him yesterday. But Jeremy always reminds us that he works under conditions of great privilege in relation to the people who are doing the most dangerous work and who are being disappeared and who cannot leave the war zones that they're working in. And beyond that, you know, Jeremy is safe and he's sound and he's very active. He continues to work. People have maybe have read about the new media initiative that he's involved with Glenn Greenwald. I think that at this moment, Jeremy feels that his work is a tributary that's joining that of a number of other reporters from around the world, and that they are forming a river to produce a new level of effectiveness in getting these stories out. And I don't know the details of what shape or form that's going to take, but far from feeling isolated, as I know Snowden must feel, I think that Jeremy feels that he's in the midst of a very broad and strengthening conversation.
David, I have one final question for you. I think there were two themes in the book that I didn't see reflected in the film, and I just wanted to see what your comments were about maybe why those weren't as prominent in the film. One was the internal struggle between the CIA drone program and JSOC for who would get the president's approval as the best killers. And the second was Jeremy's argument that it was U.S. policy in Somalia that really transformed al-Shabaab from essentially a non-player into a major, powerful, indigenous-based terrorist organization.
Yes. So for people who haven't read the book, If you enjoyed the film, you'll love the book, which is a strange thing to say. The film is neither enjoyable nor is the book something you can love, but it is, it's extremely, extremely carefully researched, and it has the ability over a long period of time to construct this story with far more complexity and nuance. To answer your two questions in reverse, Somalia is an extraordinarily complex place, and the history of what has happened in that country over the last 25 years really deserves and needs its own feature-length documentary film. We struggled with how to include Somalia, and one of the early cuts of the film had about a 10 or 15 minute sequence that showed that process that you're describing, how Al-Shabaab really was an irrelevant fringe group in this Islamic Courts Union that was a broad, deeply resonant social uprising by all sectors of society against the horrific abuses of the warlords. And Shabaab was one of these. And the way in which American policy, by polarizing the situation in Somalia and then actively creating a condition of war, played directly into the hands of al-Shabaab, felt in some ways like a metaphor for the whole story of this war on terror and the way in which it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy, the notion of blowback. But we found that the film couldn't sustain it. And the same would be true with the question you're raising about the internal battles between the CIA and JSOC. It too is complicated. In fact, to this day, I get confused on the bin Laden raid. It's a JSOC operation, but it's temporarily put under the guidance of the CIA. So we sidestepped those, and we sidestepped many other questions because we were striving to find what an audience can really absorb in an hour and a half, and what were the broad themes that had to get through. And we always talked about the forest versus the trees. We did not want to lose the forest. But there were endless trade-offs. And I know that the Somalia one in particular was the most challenging for us. You know, really it was extremely, extremely difficult. For example, to give Somalia its own complex rendering jeopardized the story of Awlaki, which itself deserves its own film. The transformation of this quote-unquote moderate voice of reason after 9/11 into the character that he became really merits a 90-minute film. And so it was a constant struggle to try and find the balance. But if that is the last question, I just want to thank the organizers, first of all. I know that Jeremy would be there if he could. He's in Florida. Richard would be there if he could. He's in California. The film continues to have a life. It's now opening theatrically in the United Kingdom in 2 weeks. It's being screened all over the United Kingdom, in Scandinavia, in Australia, New Zealand, in Brazil, in Germany and Spain. It's being translated into Arabic. And it's been extremely gratifying to see that the film is helping to bring people together to have this conversation. The film's, the main goal is to have a conversation and to raise questions, not to try and answer them. Jeremy himself is always very clear that he is not trying to tell us what we need to know. He's raising questions that are the starting point to figuring out which direction we need to go. And so my thanks on behalf of the Dirty Wars team, to everyone who did this organizing. And again, thanks for letting us participate remotely like this.
Thank you.
Thank you. And if I can say just one final word, if there's anybody here who doesn't know what's going on at Hancock Air National Guard Base, there's a lot of LOCALAC, which is the regional control center for MQ-9 Reaper drones operating in Afghanistan. There's a lot of people in the theater who can tell you about it. Thanks.
Thanks a lot. We are going to sign off, and just so you know, a lot of people stayed for all the questions and answers. So we're very thankful for you, and we'll hopefully speak to you guys again.
Okay. Thanks, Roger.
Thanks, Dave. All right, good night.